Good morning, students. In the last class, we have started a chapter, mute your mics, mute your mics. In the last class, we have started chapter number 9, that is force and laws of motion. Force and laws of motion, in that we have just discussed about what do you mean by force. An introduction part we have just discussed. So just I'm sharing a screen with you all. So for a quick revision. I think entire screen is visible to you. My screen is visible to you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let's start again with the chapter. Our chapter name is Force and Laws of Motion. In the last class, we have discussed about that what we will study in this chapter. We will study in this chapter about a force and about the Newton's laws of motions. That we have already discussed that there are three laws of motions which Newton has given. On the basis of the study of Galileo Galilei. The first was Newton's first law of motion. Second is Newton's second law of motion. And then third, Newton's third law of motion. Newton's first law of motion, as we have already discussed, that the name of this law is law of inertia. And Newton's second law of motion name is law of momentum. And Newton's third law of motion is action and reaction law. Now, first of all, we start with the force. So, what do you mean by force? What is force? Force means in the previous chapter, we have studied about motion. Motion means when an object changes its position from one point to another, then this is what? This is the motion, movement of a body. Now, this movement of a body is responsible for what? Means by which, what is the factor which makes it in motion? And that factor is force. Means force is that factor which enables the change in the body. And that change can be in the form of push. It can be in the form of pull. It can change the shape of the object, it can change the direction of the object, and much more. So, the factor which is responsible for the change in the particular position of the object, that factor is known as force. So, force is that due to which you can do any work. Without force, no one can do any work. Means force is that factor, until or unless that pressure is not there, we will not do any work. For example, previously also we have just discussed about this example, that right now studying the chapter, classes are going on. So afterwards the examination is there. When the examination will be conducted and the timetable is there in front of you, you know the date sheet, you know that exam will starting from this date, then there is some pressure on your mind, there is some force, and that factor makes you a proper attention, proper caution for continuously studying to get a good results in your examination, so that your progress report should be good. Otherwise, if the examination will be not there, then only 10%, 20% students will study for their knowledge. Otherwise, rest of the students will not do anything. The reason is because no force is there on them. Understood? So to do anything, either we push or pull the object. Therefore, push or pull is called force. Push and pull are the two conditions. First is pull. Pull means when we are when the we are just bringing the body towards ourselves, towards our body, means when we are stretching the body, or we are just making the body to come near to our body, then this position, this is known as pull. And push, when we are doing the body away from our body, when we are doing the body away from our body, then this is a pose which can be in the form of push. Now, to further, for explaining further, some examples are there in front of you. To open a door, either we push or pull it. A drawer is pulled to open and pushed to close. Whenever we open a drawer, we have to pull it. And when we are closing, then we have to push it. Now, for further clarification, we shall move to the effect of force. Now, force can make certain effects on the basis of the different types of positions. Now, first of all, we are just starting about the stationary object. When the object is at stationary position, stationary means rest position. When the object is at rest position, then it is only the force which makes the stationary object in motion. Force can make any stationary object in motion. Due to force only, a stationary object can move, start moving. Because the body initially is at rest. The body is initially at rest. And afterwards, when a force is being applied on it, then the body starts moving. So this is what force can make a stationary object into motion. For example, a football can be set to move. A football can be set to move by kicking it. Football is placed at the center of the playground. A player comes and we kicked. We applied a force on a football. The football starts moving. Means that stationary object comes to motion. Now, next effect is force can stop a moving body. For example, means when an object is moving and we need to stop it, we will apply a force. And the best example of it, application of brakes during a running vehicle. A vehicle is running and we have to stop that vehicle. Then what we will do? We will apply the brakes on it. So application of brake is also a type of a force. Application of brakes are also a type of force. Or in a running cycle, or a running vehicle can be stopped by the application of brakes. The first effect we studied about, that force can change the stationary object into motion. Next, second, we have studied about force can stop a moving body. Now we come to the third effect. Third effect is force can change the direction of a moving object. Means suppose if we talk about a cricket, then in what? A bowler is throwing the ball towards the batsman. And what batsman is doing? He is changing the direction. He is changing the direction of the ball to make the boundary. Okay, so this is what about change of direction. Many examples are more. That is, when a vehicle is being driving, then the steering of that vehicle or the handle of that vehicle is being turned to a particular direction so that the direction of the vehicle gets changed. So same example is there in front of us. By applying a force, that is by moving handle, the direction of the running bicycle can be changed. Similarly, by moving the steering, the direction of running vehicle is changed. You can quote any example. You can quote the example of cricket also. You can quote the example of football also, because in football also the same thing is going on. A player is passing the ball from one player to another player, and the another player is doing what? He is changing the direction of the ball by giving the ball to third player. So these are three effects of force till now we have studied. Now afterwards we will just study about the next effect of force, that is force can change the speed of the moving object. moving body. Force can change the speed of the moving body. Means a body is moving, suppose with a speed of 20 km per hour, and we need to increase the speed, then what we have to do? We have to give an acceleration to it. Okay, on in the every vehicle in there is an accelerator part. That accelerator part does what? It increases the speed of the object. But when we apply a force on the accelerator, when we apply a force to change the speed of that object, or if we need to decrease the speed of the object, then again we will apply a brake. So force is in both the situation when we are doing acceleration also, or when we are applying brakes also. Okay, so force can change the speed of the moving body. By accelerating, the speed of the running vehicle can be increased, or by applying brakes, the speed of the running vehicle can be decreased. The same example is here in front of you. Now the next is, force can change the shape and the size of the object. Force can change the shape and the size of the object. For example, a spring is there in your hand. When you stretch it, its shape gets changed. Or a rubber band is there. When you get to stretch it, its shape gets changed. Or suppose a balloon is there in your hand. When you compress it, its shape gets changed. So many of the examples are there in which we can say that force can change the shape and size of the object. So for example, by hammering, a block of metal can be turned into a thin sheet. By hammering, a stone can be broken into pieces. By hammering, a stone can be broken into pieces. So this was about, we have discussed about, first of all, the introduction of force. Okay, what is force? Force is that factor due to which we can change the direction, we can change the rest position, we can make the object at rest, we can change the shape and the shape and the size, and moreover we can change the speed of the object. Means that factor which enables anything to do a work. Now, forces are mainly of two types, balance forces and unbalanced forces. Balance forces, it is the resultant of applied force. Means balance force, when both the forces are being, suppose an object is there, on that object two persons are applying a force, then applying a force of equal magnitude but opposite in direction, then overall net force becomes what? Zero, and that object will not move anywhere. It means that the object is under the influence of balance forces. The object will start only moving when there is a condition of unbalanced force. Means one person is applying more force than the another one. Now before continuing with the further part, we will just go through a video. Voice is coming.
No, sir.
This is force. Force is the capacity of body to do work. No, it can push or Now, next is force results due to the interaction between two bodies. Until unless there is not an interaction, so it. Force will be not there. Force is a vector quantity because it has magnitude also and direction also. Next, we come to, that's why the essential unit of force is Newton. The amount of force needed to accelerate 1 kilogram of mass at a rate of 1 meter per second. Now there are types of forces, non-contact forces and contact forces. In non-contact forces, further forces are there. And now, what are contact forces? Contact forces are forces that result when two interacting objects are in physical contact with each other. Now, next. Gravitational force is a type of non-contact force. And magnetic force is also an example of non-contact forces, because in this bodies are not in contact with each other, then also there is some force applying on it. Now, the definition of force is there. Force is of two types, balanced and unbalanced forces. Now, an example is there in front of you that when 60 Newton force is being applied from both the sides on this object, then the body is under the condition of balanced forces. The body is under the condition of balanced forces. But in this case, when the rocket is being propelling, then it is in the condition of unbalanced forces. So that's why unbalanced forces are necessary for the motion of an object. Means for force is being applied in both the situation, but motion will only take place when unbalanced force is there. Now this is an example of unbalanced force in front of you. From one side 20 Newton, from one side 60 Newton. The body will shift to left side because the forces, unbalanced forces causes change in the motion, both speed and direction of the object. Now, next is balanced force. Balanced force means resultant force is zero, net force is zero. The resultant force of balanced force is always zero. That's why the body will not move to anywhere, any position. Means it remains on the same position. Next, effects of force. As we have discussed about effects of force, it can it is rolling. Rolling means a stationary object can move by applying a force. Force may change the motion of the object that is already in the motion or produce a motion in the stationary body. Next is, force can change the shape of the body. When we apply a force, like stretching of rubber band, pressing of a balloon, it can change the shape of the body. Force can change the position of an object. Position means right now it is coming towards the finger, now it is going away from the finger. Force can also change the direction of the body. So that's all about force and the effects of force. Now I think it is understood to everyone, okay, what is force, what are the effects of force, and what are the types of forces, that is basically balanced forces and unbalanced forces, and why unbalanced forces are necessary for the motion of an object or for any change that is being occurring in the object. Understood, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Now we come to the next portion, that is laws of motion. Laws of motion, first of all, we have Galileo Galilei was a scientist. He was the scientist who first of all said that objects move with a constant speed. All the objects move with a constant speed when no forces acts on them. Galileo was the first scientist who said that objects move with a constant speed when no forces act on them. This means that if an object is moving on a frictionless path and no other force is acting upon it, the object would be moving forever. But this is a case which is not possible. Frictionless surface is not possible. So that's why whatever the Galileo quoted, that it is being not, at that time it was not very true. Right now in this era we can make a frictionless surface, but at that time, right now also it is not possible. Every surface is having a friction, a minimum friction. We cannot say that this surface is a frictionless surface. So Galileo said that if an object is moving on a frictionless path and no other force is acting on it, then the object would be moved forever. That is, there is no unbalanced force working on it. But practically it is not possible, as I said to you, because to attain the condition of zero, unbalanced force is impossible. Force of friction, force of air, and many other forces are always acting upon the object. For example, if a ball is being rolling on a ground and no player is there, that after a certain period of time, that balls gets automatically stopped. The reason is, what was the reason? Because there is a force which is hidden, and that force is force of friction, and that force is applying between what? Between the surface of the ball and the surface of the ground. On between both of them, there is a friction force, and due to that, the ball automatically gets stopped. So, what actually Galileo suggested at that time, Galileo said that when a two-piece, one more experiment Galileo has done, that is, he made fall of two things from a certain height of a certain building, at the terrace of the certain building. Then, one is feather and one is stone. He said that when both the things are being fall at the same time, then both are coming on the ground at the same time, because the force acting on them are same. But this will not actually happens when we are doing, because he has given this for a vacuum situation. But when we make it in a practical situation, the stone will come first and the feather will come afterwards. The reason is because there is force of air, force of friction, and the feather is lightweight. So it will take more time, because opposite force is there to withhold. The same force is on the stone also, but stone is heavy, that's why it is coming fast. Actually, Galileo said, the meaning of Galileo, the concept of Galileo, to explain this concept is that when an object is coming from any free fall, when any objects are coming from the free fall, then the force, the acceleration on that object is always same. And that we say that 9.8 meter per second acceleration due to gravity. Actually, Galileo suggested this point, but at that time there was a lack of discoveries. That's why the exact value of force of gravity or acceleration due to gravity was not there. So he was not able to explain it properly. But after the study of Galileo Galilei, Newton studies the ideas of Galileo and gave three laws of motion. These three laws are known as Newton's laws of motion, because it is being implemented by the Newton. So now, first of all, we just came to Newton's first law of motion. And as I have already suggested you, that Newton's first law of motion is also known as law of inertia. Before coming to the Newton's first law of motion, we should know about law of inertia, or we can say we should know about inertia. What is inertia? Have you ever heard about inertia? Anyone?
Sir, if an object is stressed or in motion, it will continue to be at that state until an unbalanced force acts on it.
That is Newton's first law of motion. And you have just stated correctly law. But I am just asking about inertia. What is inertia? Can you explain about inertia?
Sir, it is the tendency of that object to remain at rest or motion until...
Yes, correct. Tendency means inertia is the tendency or the capability or the property of a body which resists the change in the object. Means it is the inertia is there in every object, and every object in this universe resists the upcoming change. For example, object is at rest. It remains to be at rest. But we are applying a force on it to change its the position of rest. Means in this case, the inertia of object which is applying a force is more than the inertia of that object. Now, inertia And it has inertia is property of an object, tendency of an object to resist the upcoming change. But inertia is dependent on mass. Inertia is directly dependent on mass, or we can say that inertia is directly proportional to mass. More the mass of the object, more will be the inertia. For example, three persons are there who are sitting. One is of 10 kg, one is of 50 kg, and one is of, for example, 150 kg. Now, the person who is of 10 kg is applying a force on a person of 150 kg to change its position. But it is not possible, because the inertia of a person who is having 150 kg mass is very much more than the person who is having a weight of mass of 10 kg. This is the more the mass, more will be the tendency to resist the change. It does not mean it is only for the rest position. It is for the moving position also. Now, for a moving position, suppose if we are talking about that the continuously the vehicle is moving, and suddenly we want to just resist that change, means we want that the moving object comes to rest, we apply a brakes. On application of brakes, what happens? There is a friction between the surface of the road and the surface of the tires, and due to that the tires get distorted. Clear? The tires get distorted. And that's why we say that friction is devil for us in some of the cases. And friction is evil for us in some of the cases. It is useful in some of the cases, and it is harmful in some of the cases. Okay? Now, on this basis, inertia is being divided into three parts. First is inertia of rest. Second is inertia of motion. And third is inertia of direction. Now we take the example of inertia of rest. Suppose you are sitting in a car or a bus, and the bus is also in the rest position. Suddenly the bus starts moving. You feel a backward jerk. The reason is, when you are along in the rest position with the bus, when the bus is also in the rest, your body is also in the rest. Your body attains a position of rest. Your body attains a position of rest. But suddenly the bus starts moving. Your feet, which are in contact with the surface of the bus, also starts moving with the bus. And your body, upper portion of the body, remains to be at same state. That's why we feel a backward jerk. Now, again we come to the next video, so that you can able to clearly understand about Newton's first law. Newton's first law. It is showing that in our day-to-day life, we are experiencing a certain activities. But suppose a bowler is kicking a ball, it continues to be in the motion and automatically it comes to rest. Why? Because there is a force of friction between the surface and the ball. Now, a body continues to be at rest. Now, what is Newton's first law? Newton's first law states that a body continues to be in its state of rest or of uniform motion unless acted upon by an unbalanced external force. A body continues to be in this state of rest or of uniform motion until or unless any external force, unbalanced external force, is acting on it. So, next is tug of war. It's an example. From both the sides, the equal magnitude of force is being applied. Okay, that's why this is of balanced force. Now, unbalanced force. From one side, the force is more towards the left side. That's why the person will go towards the left side. Now next is inertia. Inertia of rest, inertia of direction, and inertia of motion. This is an example which we have quoted in right now. Suppose the person is standing and the bus is also at rest and start moving, then he gets a backward jerk. The reason is inertia of rest. When the person is at rest and the bus is also at rest and suddenly the bus starts moving, then what happens? Then the lower part of the person starts moving towards the front and backward remains on the same position. That's why these conditions occur of backward position. Now this is ball. Suddenly we replace, the ball goes because ball remains at rest. So this is an example. Now this is inertia of motion. It is an example of inertia of motion or direction. So next we come to another example. The body continues to be in motion and suddenly the brakes are applied. Then what happens? Due to the inertia of motion, we feel the force towards the front side. The bus is continuous in the motion. Your body is also in the motion along with the bus. As suddenly the bus stops, your feet also stops. But your upper portion remains to be in the motion. That's why you feel an forward force. So this is the reason of inertia of motion. Now next is inertia of direction. Now inertia of direction, this is go to another position. Now the direction is being changed. Clear? So this is all about Newton's first law of motion. Now again come back to a proper explanation. So now you everyone understood about Newton's first law of motion. Newton's first law states that an object remains in the state of rest or in the uniform motion along a straight line until it is compelled to change the state by applying an external force. Now there are some examples of Newton's first law in everyday life. This we have already understood. And the more important part of it is inertia, because inertia is the key of Newton's first law of motion. Inertia and mass, both are interrelated with each other. Now what is inertia? Again we just come to a proper definition of the property of an object because of which it resists to get disturbed its state. It's called inertia. Inertia of object is measured by its mass. Inertia is directly proportional to the mass. This means inertia increases with the increase in mass and decreases with the decrease in mass. A heavy object will have more inertia than a lighter one. We have already taken an example. In other words, the natural tendency of an object that resists the change in the state of motion or arrest of the object is called inertia. So that's about Newton's first law of motion. In the next class, we will just continue with the Newton's second law of motion. So I think so it is clear to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So thank you all for attending the class. I will send the notes to you. We just revise the notes. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you.